Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for joining us today for this PestExtra live presentation. And this is our final technical theatre presentation. We're going to hear from Dr Jette Knudsen, the Nattaro Labs in Sweden, talking about the bed bugs and early treatment and monitoring. But just before we get on with the presentation, just a few housekeeping items from me. Hopefully most of you are familiar with the CPD and how it works at the moment, but just in case, it's all based on your activity. So the more hours that you are with us, the more points you will get. It's 1 point for each 1 hour of activity. Now that's seeing exhibitors, looking at seminars like you are now, watching videos and just interacting with us. So yeah, make sure you carry on with that throughout the rest of today. We are going to have a Q&A section at the end of this presentation. You'll see an option to click on a Q&A and submit your question, a button at the bottom, top or side of your screen, depending on what device you're using. At the end of presentation, I'll read these out for the presenter to answer live. You can be anonymous if you wish. All attendees can see the questions that you're submitting also. So a really great thing about this is that if you see a question somebody else has submitted, then why not give it a thumbs up, like that question. And the more people that like a particular question, the more likely I'm going to get to that. So sometimes we can get a lot of questions in, can't always get to them all. So again, if you see a question you really like, give it that thumbs up and it will pop up to the top of my list. Okay. In terms of technical problems, you'll see a orange button which says live support somewhere on your screen, normally at the top. And again, if you have any sound or video issues, you can always put it in the discussion forum, but mainly in this live support section. For the discussion forum, if you just want to make some comments or some observations, or you want to have a chat to any of the attendees or myself or the BPCA moderator, then make sure you use the discussion forum, okay? Don't submit your questions to the presenter in the discussion forum. We won't be able to get to them there. Okay, that's just for chat. And then the last thing, I can't see you or hear you, and neither can the presenter. So if you want to chat to us, then please come and see us on the BPCA stand, okay? Fabulous. Well, without further ado, Dr. Jette Knudsen, if you would like to continue. Thank you.
Yeah. Hello. I'm Jette Knudsen. And I go to this here. I thank the organizer for the opportunity to speak here at PestExtra, as being the last in this theater. I have the pleasure of being able to listen to some of the others and can incorporate some of their presentations into mine. And as you heard yesterday, Jeff White from Bedbug Central talking about severe bedbug infestation and how to treat them in the United States, then you know it can be a very huge problem to get rid of bedbugs, and you really have to know your organism to treat them and get rid of them. But unfortunately, we cannot get bedbugs not to go into our homes. They come with our luggage and they come with all kinds of things into our homes. But if we detect them very early on and we treat them very early on, then we can get rid of them faster and minimize human suffering and expenses for treatment. In my talk, I will focus on how Nattaro Labs, or Nattaro Labs, depending on if you pronounce it in Swedish or in English, have combined research with knowledge on bedbug biology and behavior to develop a monitor trap with an attractive lure imitating the bug's aggregation pheromone and a bed tape filled with diatomaceous earth to protect the human sleeping and resting places, and thus minimizing the risk for dispersal of bed bugs also to adjacent units. But first, a little bit about the bed bugs themselves. There are a little more than 100 known species in the family of Simicidae. They are all ectoparasites and obligate blood feeders. And most have a host specialist, and two-thirds have bats as host, and about one-third have birds. However, three species are found on human hosts, of which two, Cimex lectularius, the common bedbug, and Cimex hemipterus, the tropical bedbug, almost cosmopolitan. Cimex hemipterus, a topical one. I said cosmopolitan because now it enters into temperate areas also, because we are traveling, or did traveling prior to 2020, to many tropical countries, and we have heating systems in our homes that make the temperature sufficient for them to develop and thrive. So we may see hemipterus in infestations as well as electrolarius. They are all flightless, and it's thank God. With the only thing that is left of their remnants of their wings are these wing pads here, that tells us they have been derived from an ancestor with wings. But as they have evolved together on into a parasitic lifestyle, the wings would have been in way, and also they have developed a flattened body, and they have a tigmatactic behavior that they will want to be in contact with the surroundings, and also a cryptic behavior, they want to stay out of the view. And these characteristics together make them hard to treat and hard to find. And they're mainly night active. That's when the host usually is sleeping. But if the host changes its behavior and start to work during night and sleep during day, there's no problem for the bedbugs to turn into a daily night activity. They shy the lights and get away from it. And one thing that makes them very well adapted to our modern houses is that they are extremely tolerant to desiccation. They can stand long periods without food. And then they have aggregation behavior, as you see in here, that they kind of collect themselves in heaps. And that's also that's a way to conserve moisture. And especially for the nymphs, it's important because they are not as well equipped as the adults to keep their balance. They are all excellent climbers, using their claws on the food on rough surfaces, but when they are on glass surfaces, or here plastic petri dish, both the tropical and the temperate bedbug have plungers, called tibial pads, in that they can climb on pure glass, moving upwards and downwards. And that is something that is very important when you consider making traps and how reliable they are. Here researchers have made experiments where they have three types of traps, and then they have released a number of bedbugs, other tropical ones or the common bedbug, into the traps, and then 72 hours later they looked at how many had escaped from the traps. And the dark or the black column here is a tropical bedbug, the percentage that were escaping from the traps, and the gray one is the common bedbugs. And as you see, the tropical bedbugs, which have larger tibial pads or plungers, is much better at escaping from all the three kinds of traps. But even the temperate one is able to escape from this type of trap. And that's good to have in your head when you're using traps. The nose of the bedbug sits in the antennae, where there's a lot of sensory or olfactory hairs with olfactory sensilla that can detect different scent molecules in the surroundings. And different hairs may have different affinities for different scents. It's not that bedbugs can detect any scent, but they can detect many of those that are relevant for its living and survival. And the last thing that is important for what I'm going to talk on further on is the epicuticle, the outer layer of the bed bugs. It's consisting of a wax layer, wax and lipid layer, that functions to reduce water loss, and also it blocks intrusion or make it more difficult for example, pesticides or insecticides to enter into the body of the bed bug. So if we can destroy this layer, then we can destroy their ability to keep the water balance. Bed bugs are feeding on blood only, and the two species I'm mainly talking about feeds on only or almost only on human blood, but they can take blood from under other mammals, or I should have said vertebrates, because they take from birds also. There are some constraints in the food, in the blood, because it has low nutrient per volume. So the bed bugs need to get rid of the water content or the fluid in the blood very fastly to concentrate the nutrients. And that's what we see these fecal pellets on the surroundings where bed bugs have been. I will show a picture later next. But also they are under thermal stress because the blood is around 37 degrees and bed bugs have the surroundings temperature. So they need to get rid of the heat very fastly, which they have mechanism to do within a few minutes after they have eaten. And they are not able to synthesize vitamin B. So instead it is provided by a bacterial symbiont, Wolbachia, that gain nutrients from the bed bug, and the bed bug gets the B vitamins. And here are some examples of traces from bed bugs from their fecal spots here. And here it can come in different colors, a little depending on how concentrated it is. And we have an unfed first instar nymph and a satiated first instar nymph. They look beautiful, don't they? And then we have a fully fed adult. And here show some eggs, which when they are recently hatched, they are kind of having a mother of pearl shine on them. And here you have one that has not hatched yet. And with a little lid here, you can see it's here in this picture. That falls off, and the small nymph gets out of the eggshell, and they are left behind. Now that's traces also to look for. And a few days before egg hatch, you will see a red eye spot. So they are beautiful to look at. The bedbug life cycle, when they have fed, they need to feed before they mate, and the female is able to lay eggs, and the male is able to produce seminal fluid and sperms. But when they have eaten and they have mated, eggs are laid, and when they hatch, the first instar nymph comes out, and you have five instars of bedbug nymphs, each increasing in size and becoming, they are like small miniature bedbugs, but with less color. And as they increase in size, they get darker and darker. But to go from one stage to the next, they need a blood meal. So each of these is a necessary blood meal to continue the life cycle. And within small nymphs, first and second instar being very delicate and sensitive, that is probably one of the reasons why bed bugs mostly infest the host area where the host is resting, because then it's close for the smaller bed bug nymphs to get to the food, and they need the food to continue their life cycle. So if the eggs were laid far away, the likelihood that the small nymphs would reach to the food and be able to develop into the next stage would be much smaller. So that's probably an important point to make, why the bed bugs in most cases are found very close to the host. Adults normally lives for six to nine months, and adults can survive up to or more than 12 months without food at lower temperatures, because at 13 degrees or lower, bedbugs start eating and lower their metabolic rates. They go into some kind of hibernation, and eggs do no longer hatch. The female can lay 2 to 5 eggs per day, so that can become quite many during a lifetime. And more, very important is that the life cycle, this is for him, Lectulae, the common bedbug, is temperature dependent. So if you have a place with 33 degrees, then the whole life cycle would take 36 days. And if you have only 18 degrees, it will take 128 days. So higher temperature use increases the potential for a population to increase very fast. And we make the hypothetical development of a bedbug infestation with one mated female that starts to lay egg. She's introduced into your home, starts to lay egg, and the egg hatch and the first nymphs appear. She continues to lay eggs for about 4 or 5 weeks. Then she does not have more, sufficient sperms to continue laying fertilized eggs. So only new nymphs are from the eggs laid prior is coming out. But after about 7-8 weeks, the new adults start to eclose, and they can start to mate, and new females and also the old one can continue to lay eggs, and new nymphs appear. And what it will come to a point here, when you get from a linear increase to an exponential increase in numbers, and that means that we have a window of about 9-10 weeks before the increase in the population or goes really fast. So if we can detect and treat during this period of time, a lot is saved. So how is the situation in the UK now? I was trying to get numbers of treatments from pesticide companies or control companies, but I didn't succeed. Then my colleague Christine, she made a Google search using the keywords bedbug and bedbugs in Google, because the interest and the searches people are making on Google reflects to a very good degree, in Sweden at least, how the situation is with the number of treatments that the companies are doing. So it took from 2004 and until now. And as we can see from around 2019, we have a decrease in interest, meaning that other fewer bedbugs or fewer treatments are made. But also here, we probably have come to a point where people have learned more about bedbugs and how they look and what they should look for. And also pest control technicians have been much more better to treat the bedbugs with integrated pest management. And as Jeff White told us yesterday, the impact of the COVID-19 on bedbugs was quite severe also, because a lot of the bedbugs coming into our homes come from when we have been traveling far away. And during the last year, almost no one have been traveling. So prior to 2020, as a result of globalization and increased travels, we saw, including migration, we saw bedbugs introduction, where bedbugs travel as stowaways, that resulted in the huge increase in interest for bedbugs and resurgence in the Western world. And traditional methods of treatments became less and less efficient as bedbugs evolved resistance mechanism to most known insecticides. So new solutions and strategies were needed. And But the simple question was what? Let's see. Nattaro Labs, or Nattaro Labs, was from the beginning, they took on the bedbug challenge with the goal that through knowledge and creativity make a difference to all those that were affected by bedbug infestation. And this year, it's 10 years since it was founded. And they knew that bedbugs, to about 90%, is very close to the human resting area, usually the bed. So to protect the host against, they wanted to build some kind of a wall around the bed or the resting area to keep the sleeping person safe. And early treatment work should concentrate on securing these areas and avoid dispersal to adjacent areas. So the challenge was to develop something less conspicuous than the wall you see on this slide, but with the same concept. And the four founders started to educate themselves by visiting infested apartments and properties and interviewed people that were affected, and they investigated how pest control conducted pest treatments, and they studied the biology and behavior in the lab. In the field, and they wanted to find out something that they can use to treat in this area of the developmental curve. In the field, they saw that technicians were using diatomaceous earth, which is fossilized diatoms that have been milled into very small pieces. And because of the silicium skeleton of the diatoms, it has a diatomaceous earth has a huge surface and a very strong absorptive power that destroys, if you remember, absorbs the lipid and wax layer that usually protects the bed bugs and help them to conserve water. So by removing it using diatomaceous earth, they are not able to control the water loss from the bodies. But what they saw, the founders of Nattaro Labs, was that when the diatomaceous earth was spread, it got very dusty in the air and didn't look very good when they have heaps of dust around, and most likely people would start to vacuum very soon after they have left, because who wants to live with this? So if they in some way could constrain the diatomaceous earth within some kind of construction, much would be gained. And what they came out with was this construction here, where you have a triangle with diatomaceous earth inside. And we did studies of how these dust band or bedbug tapes, how efficient they were or are, putting them into smaller containers and introducing. Here they are open. Usually they should be folded like a triangular, so the bedbugs want to hide in, and often the bedbugs stay for longer time in, even with diatomaceous earth, and they stay here in where the bent, the wings are bended, because there they get mostly in contact with both on more sites with the surrounding, their tick-tactic behavior. What we did here is kind of a imitation of what we want, how we want to use the tape, put it up between where the bedbugs are hiding or have their harborages in the bed or sofa or where they are, and on the way to the host to place this diatomaceous filled tape in between. So every time they pass from their hiding places up to the host to feed, they pass through, and when they go back, they pass through. And did experiments here, imitating this behavior, putting in a number of bedbugs here, let them go for 1 hour, then we picked them up and fed them to for at least 20 minutes, and then let them back here. and then recorded, depending on whether it was adults or nymphs, every day or every week of how they died off. And what we found was that with the adults, we used 10 adult males and 10 adult females in each diatomaceous earth treated box, and the same in each of the control boxes. And after a week, the blue columns here is the number or the percentage of dead adults. And only after a week, 98% of the adults had died. And after 2 weeks, 100% had died. If you look at the orange columns, then very few of the control animals have died. However, if you look at the eggs that were laid in the control boxes, you see the potential for the population to increase over time. And also you see this from the egg laying and onto the eggs hatch and the nymph appear in the control boxes. There's a time delay, but this curve will follow the egg curve. So there's potential for really a high increase. The day diatomaceous earth treated adults did lay some eggs, and a few nymphs hatch, but they died very soon after they hatch, because most of the eggs, they were actually, the few eggs that were laid, they were laid in the diatomaceous earth in the inside the Nattaro safe. Death curve of the nymphs that were exposed to diatomaceous earth and their controls here. The blue is the diatomaceous treated, and these are the controls. About 50 first instar nymphs were released into the middle of the experimental setup, and for an hour, and then they were picked up and fed and released again. However, because they are very delicate, the nymphs, and we had to use forceps to both pick them up and release them again, we have rather high death rate also among the controls. But there's no doubt between the two, we had that it's very efficient against the nymphs also. We had one nymph that in some way, probably it managed to go, or it went through some of the slits here, where it didn't get contaminated with the diatomaceous earth, because there was one nymph that survived and fed. They were fed on day 7 and on day 14, and this one survived until day 17. But what we can say is that we do break the life cycle. So either with the nymphs or with the adults. So eventually they will all die out. If it's a big infestation, you need additional methods, but with small infestation and early infestation, and you probably take them from the very beginning. We had the opportunity to test or see how Nattaro Safe was working in the field in a collaboration with the Swedish immigration my authorities. In one of the larger towns, they had 59 apartments that they were following, where they have their customers or the immigrants living. And we were able or allowed to set up Nattaro Safe in 15 of these, on all the beds in 15 of these apartments. And then after 6 months, we came back and they have followed all of the apartments. And in these apartments where no Nattaro Safe were installed, they had received 1 to 5 insecticidal treatments during this period. Whereas in the apartments where Nattaro Safe was installed, only one apartment there was reported bed bugs, and though it was not, it was, and it was just recently treated when we were there. So that to us indicated that it made a big difference in these environments. So Nattaro Safe is good to use in high-risk accommodation, like students' homes, refugees, social housing, and care homes. And there are many ways you can install it. And also, I forgot to say that the bedbugs really like this paper construction and hide inside it, some, even when you have the diatomaceous earth in it. But they have to pass by it to enter to it. So it is very much up to you to place them in the pass where the insect go by from where they hide and go up to eat on the host in the bed or couch or where they are. Also big behind headboards, and so it's good to place them or furniture close to the bed. But a third or another application is behind skirtings. Bedbugs like to hide behind skirtings, and if you can avoid or kill them when they get into the skirtings, then you can diminish or minimize the risk of dispersal to adjacent units. And we have, in collaboration with a number of companies in Sweden, developed the safe to be put behind skirtings. Other, you can put it up when you're renovating units or also in new buildings. Several companies are using Nattaro Safe in constructions. And this is from an aquarium where we wanted to see what happens. And they had other opportunities to be there, but they went also to the diatomaceous earth. Coming to monitoring, which is so important also for early detection. If you, for one reason or another, cannot have Safe, or you can have both monitoring and Nattaro Safe. But for early detection and to also to attract bedbugs in very small population when it's difficult to find them because they hide in cracks and crevices, and control if a treatment has been efficient, and then also we need escape-free traps, as we learned. And as I have a background in chemical ecology, and so I sort of need to go in and look to the chemical bedbug communication systems. And it is well known that bedbugs have some scent glands that produce and emit from which 2-hexanal and 2-octanal is emitted from, and that nymphs have on the dorsal side of their abdomen, they have three additional, or they have three glands that contain the same compounds plus some nymph-specific compounds. And what makes so complicated the thing is that bedbugs do not have sexual pheromones, or at least they have not been found yet, if they have, which the usual way to monitor in many other insects, that is to use sexual pheromones. But here we had to use or rely on something else. And with these chemicals, when they are released in high concentration, they function as a repellent, an alarm pheromone, or that is repellent and defensive. And but in low concentration, they are an attraction, attracting the bedbugs to their aggregation. So to find something in this, to try to single out what determines where the borders, how much is too much and how little is too little, and are there other things to their chemical communication. And after I've seen a study by Richard Naylor, where he looked at how many adult bedbugs they usually are in an aggregation or harborage, he came out that in four different strains, he had around 30 average adults in one aggregation before they went to a new one. The distance could vary depending probably of which material it was made on. They liked some materials better than others, and also on how many bedbugs there were in total, of course. And then the bedbug comes here and, should I stay here? Are there too many? Because the risk of diseases may be higher when you have a dense population. And so maybe it's time to go to a new place, but they can't count, but they use their antennae to sniff whether the sniff what compounds or concentration there are in the air to decide whether to leave or not. And I took I wanted to use this behavior to try to find out if there are some differences in the chemicals, if you have a dense population or if you have a very small populations. And I set up an experiment where I had 18, 36, 54, 72, or 144 nymph females and males in these containers where we keep the bed bugs. And then I used an old methodology from perfume science with passive sampling called enfleurage. So I put absorbent on top of the netting that was above the colonies here. And then after a week, I collected the adsorbent and extracted it with organic solvents. This is the control, and I can see it's not, but there was no animals in the controls that we used. And then after extracting the scent, I run it through the gas chromatograph, where you have the result here coming out. It separates the compounds according to their volatility in a gradient, temperature gradient program. And then each of these, when they are separated, the peaks, they go into the mass spectrometer where they are bombarded with electrons and come out with a kind of a fingerprint. So each compound look differently, at least in most cases. And you have to interpret what the fingerprint, what compound that is. And after having looked at, I don't know how many, but hundreds of these chromatograms, came out with about 20 different compounds that had some kind of variation according to the densities of bed bugs. And they were tested in arenas here where we had the scent here in one, and then we had two controls, and we looked at how the bed bugs were dispersing in the arena, and we had the lure here. The best lure and the one that are in the Nattaro Scout today. And we were quite satisfied with six, on average, six of 10 female bed bugs with 21 replicates, and slightly less of the males were going into the scented zone. So more than five, between five and six went into. And then we wanted to make it more realistic environment, and had boxes here where we had a trap loaded with the active lure and a control trap without the lure, and looking and have additional hiding places. So and what we found here was that after activating the lure at the start and adding five females and five males into the box, four bed bugs were caught during the first week, and then they were removed, and 10 new bed bugs were added during the second week. We had less than around five, and more than five during the third week with new bed bugs introduced here. And in all cases, it was significantly less than we had in the control. So we had a system that worked quite well there. And then we made some comparisons to other active lures on the market. And here its comparison is made with hit rate, which is the probability to capture one or more bed bugs per week in the lure traps. And Nattaro Scout is between 90 and 100% probability to capture one or more bed bugs, while competitor A was between 25 and 35, and competitor B was even less. So we had a lure that was good compared to those mostly on the market. And one of the reasons, I think, apart from we hit some of the compounds that were useful or used by the bed bugs to detect population densities, that's also that we have. I will go on to the next one here. I have the trap here. If I don't have the holder here, then the scent will disperse straight up. But when we have the holder, the scent is more forced down to the surface where the bed bugs are. And since they cannot fly, they cannot detect what is up here in the air. They only detect what is along the substrate, and they can only react onto these. So with the airflow and the plumes of odor and the trap placements, that are the most important things when you're working with the bed bug detection here. You don't do not have very much air movement in bedrooms. You have the dust under the bed in most places, I think. So you have to place the bed bug traps very way where the largest chance of bed bug passing by, like here, the legs of a bed, or in between mattresses or along the skirtings. So you have to think of how the bed bug is behaving and place the traps out accordingly. So then you have the largest likelihood to attract bed bugs. Thank you. So any questions?
Thank you for that. That was amazing. So yeah, we've got lots and lots of questions. I've highlighted a few of them. There's been lots of votes for one particular one. So the question is, are there any new products being worked on behind the scenes for future control of bed bugs that you know of?
Yeah, please repeat.
Sorry, are there any... my throat as well. So do you know of any new products that are being worked on to better help with the control of bed bugs as time goes on for the future?
New products, you said new products. I think what is not really new products, there are new products for monitoring and so. But what is more is the integrated pest management, that you just don't only rely on pesticides or insecticides. You have to use a number of treatment methods. But if you start, when you start and use monitoring, and like here we have used diatomaceous earth constrained in Nattaro Safe, then we are on a good way to keep the populations down and have an easier treatment and even treat them by just having these measures in the apartment.
Fantastic. Do apologize, my voice is going a little bit. So if it does, can you hear me okay? Can you hear me? Yep, fabulous.
Yeah.
So the next question is there a fake host that can be used? For example, if monitors or a treatment is carried out, and because the person has to stay in the room afterwards to attract the bed bugs out, is there something that can be put in the bed that mimics someone, you know, that emits the vibration, the change in CO2?
What is used by some pest controllers is to use dry ice, which gives up carbon dioxide that activates the bed bugs to get them move around. And if you have empty place, and you can, this will get them walk around. Even if you have residuals like diatomaceous earth or some chemicals with a residual effect, they may get into contact with it because they are activated. Else they will more sit and stay put because they save energy.
Yeah, it's a tricky one. Attracting those bed bugs has always been tricky, hasn't it? Yeah,
yep.
Has been tricky. I think there's a bit of a delay in the sound, but just one more question before we need to end. So do bed bugs go after one particular blood group?
That's a good question. And I say, I don't know, but there are some blood groups like the O blood group. It has less dense blood, or so that may be easier for the bed bugs to get out. But on the other hand, then they have to concentrate it more. But I don't know of any research done on which blood groups. But there are sayings that some people are bitten much more by bed bugs, and if you have a couple, it may bed bugs may only eat on one of the persons in the couple, and not the other. And probably some part of it is the scent that the host exudes. So some host scents are more preferred than others. There is one study done on, and the bed bugs, I was into it, and the bed bugs, they like my scent.
Oh no.
So
yeah, it's interesting because people do say that to us a lot. It might be bed bugs, it might be mosquitoes, really any biting insect. They say, oh, they bite me, but they don't bite my partner. But could it actually be that they are biting both? It's just one person is reacting more aggressively to the bites compared to the other.
Yeah. It could very well be, because about 30% of people don't react to bed bug bites. And these are really badly off because it takes usually much longer time before they realize they have an infestation. It's usually when they have visitors from other places coming in that, oh, you have bed bugs. No, I have not seen any, but that's because they don't react to it before it becomes really severe. And also older people react less as their immune system is less efficient or less active. So that's also where you often see very severe infestation. And part of it may be because they don't feel that they again got bitten. So it can be both.
Absolutely.
That you don't feel it, and
great. Yeah, no, it is. We're just unfortunately we won't have any time for any more questions because we're already over a bit. It doesn't matter. I wanted to be able to get that in there, but I think that you know, the end point with this is that, you know, bed bugs are a really distressing insect to have, aren't they, for members of the public, and with pest professionals us dealing with them, it's really important we, you know, have this information you're giving us and learn about them in more detail, because that helps us to, you know, get to the root of the problem and solve it, really, doesn't it?
Yes. You're very welcome to send emails questions and so to
fabulous. Yeah, we will. So I mean, that's my message to the attendees. The question, we've got 8 questions on there we haven't managed to get to, so why not take a note of it and then you know, write it down somewhere, pop it over to BPCA, and we'll get it out to Dr. Hudson. You'll be happy with that, wouldn't you?
Oh, yes, that would be
fabulous.
Great for me.
Great. That'd be amazing. Okay, well, thank you so much for that. That was absolutely brilliant. And have a great rest of the day, Dr.
Yeah, the same. And thank you if you let me participate.
No problem.
That was great.
Take care now. And everyone to the attendees, take care. And thank you for seeing us.